Well, hello everyone, and welcome on board with myself, Scott. It's a crisp and cold morning here in the Sabi Sands, here on Juma Private Game Reserve. Apparently, it's only 10 degrees Celsius, or about 51 degrees Fahrenheit, but I personally think that update is incorrect. It seems certainly colder than yesterday, and apparently it was 9 degrees and about 49 degrees Fahrenheit yesterday morning. So there's debate as to the reports we're getting, because it is a very crisp morning. You would have noticed the beautiful skeletons of two or three old knobthorn trees that Wium has just showed you. And that's the team on this vehicle this morning. Scott and Wium, and James and Bryan are on the other vehicles. So the plan so far that we've devised is for the two of us to work the southern half of Juma, and James and Bryan are going to work the northern boundary, in the hope that there's a chance of the Birmingham coalition of five male lions coming south into our property. We haven't seen them since about January or February. They've moved further north from here, but they've been lingering very close. Basically, yesterday they arrived quite close to our northern boundary, and he's going to be checking over there. For those of you who may be joining for the first time, it's a live safari, so we don't know what's going to happen, but we have got this plan in place so far. Anything could happen along the way. And without any further ado, we shall continue and see what we can find. We've got some updates last night from Purple Rain, thanks very much, from the Juma waterhole cam. She said she heard quite a lot of audio of lion and hyena, and actually saw a hyena crossing the Juma Dam wall a couple of hours ago. So thanks for those updates. And I wonder where exactly those lion were calling. Now, it's not only a live safari for the newcomers, it's also interactive. So if you'd like to ask either myself or James questions at any moment, it's really easy to do so. You hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or send an email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Excuse me. It's a little bit of mist in the lower lying valleys. It seems to be dissipating, but it's a very moody morning here. And after the action we've been having the last week or so, I've got good feelings about our luck continuing. We've had incredible success and quality sightings with big cats, both lion and leopard, as well as a lot of the other characters that we get out here. But there certainly has been a lot of good opportunities to spend time with the big cats. It's not always like that, so when they are around, we tend to try and make the most of it, and that goes for all the animals. Because we can't choose what we're going to see, we simply have to make the most of whatever's out there. I hope you all enjoyed the fireside chat last night. I've seen some dung on the road here. I just want to try and establish who was responsible for depositing it. You can see it just over my right shoulder over there. And who would have thought that coming across fresh dung excites me in the morning? It's hard to say what it's from. I couldn't see any tracks of who may have dropped it there, but I'm going to drive forward a little bit. It could be a leopard. It looks leopard-like in size. And this road's quite hard, so not too easy to see tracks, but I'm certainly going to keep a close eye out as we continue down this road. It's one of the ways that we find animals out here. The primary way in which you find animals is luck. We just drive around until we bump into one, but we also sometimes manage to track them down, and any sign like that dung in the road can be very useful in terms of helping us piece together the puzzle of what's happened in the night when we're all snug in bed. There's a lot of movement out here in the bush. And every morning we come out almost with a clean slate, not knowing what a lot of the animals may have done in the night. Ahead, you can notice a little bit of that misty scenery that I was talking about a few moments ago. And it always makes for exciting times, I feel. There's something about the mist that makes this environment a little bit more, not spooky, but I feel a little bit more on edge in this mist. Hopefully there's a reason for that this morning. The area we're heading into, we could possibly bump into the Inkahuma pride of lion, or possibly Karula, a female leopard. She's been spending a little bit of time out here. And James did have tracks of her in this area yesterday afternoon, in this general area. So with a bit of luck, we may bump into her. Got a much better view of this low-lying mist, and we'll just give you an opportunity to have a closer look while I answer a question from Jilly in Milwaukee. Thanks for sending your question through, and good to have you with us. Jilly mentioned that the dung could have possibly been from a wild dog, and that's a very good observation, Jilly. It most certainly could have been wild dog that deposited that little dropping on the road, but I couldn't see any tracks of who it may have been. If I had have got off the vehicle and spent some time there, it may have been a bit, well, I may have been able to work it out, but what there may have been. Anyway, we are gonna send you over to James to get an update on how his morning's going, and we'll catch up with you all a little bit later.
Morning, everybody. I just let you hang there for a while so that you could listen to the marvelous African dawn that is happening all around us. A winter dawn with not a huge amount of noise, just a very subtle amount of bird song. And we stopped up here on a ridge crest because there's just a lovely warm breeze coming. I believe Scott is suspicious of the weather reports. Admission that this is 10 degrees Celsius and 51 Fahrenheit. I know where Scott's driving, and I think down in the dips there it's probably a lot colder. Up here I'd put it at about 14. What do you think, Bryan? Mm. So it's not too bad where we are. Wium has lent me his gloves. They, ironically, are much larger than Scott's gloves, and so I have to take them off to operate the radio and most of the vehicle. You are most welcome. It's lovely to have you on board. We had a marvelous evening last night with some leopard and various other action, lots of hyena action. We are now driving down the northern boundary in an easterly direction towards what will soon be the rising sun, and hoping to see if the five Birmingham males, which are a young coalition of five males, for those who don't know, have come perhaps across onto Juma. We can't go north of where we are now. So we're just checking this boundary to see if there aren't any tracks on the road. And so far, nothing. But just, there's a really lovely atmosphere around. It's warm. There's a warm breeze on the crests here. Lovely fresh smell in the air of the African morning. My name is James, for those who don't know. Bryan is on camera. He's dressed up in a rather odd, astonishing array of different colors, really. He's purple scarf, orange ruff. He's looking pretty good set for the winter. Any questions or comments, we love to hear from you. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Anything you'd like to know, especially before we get into the sort of meat of the sightings, that is a hopeful statement, of course, please fire away. We'd love to chat as we drive along through the marvelousness of what is the Greater Kruger National Park. Hello, Molly in Ohio. I'll just stop the car here. You want to know if we get a white-bellied sunbird here? Absolutely, we do. And they're one of the nice sort of colorful birds that hang around throughout the winter. I will show you a picture in this field guide. And if we see one live, I haven't seen one for a while, to be honest. But if we do see one, I will stop and show you. Molly in Ohio. There is the white-bellied sunbird. The sunbirds are beautifully colored birds. They're the most colorful birds that we get out here. There he is there. And that's the male there with the spectacular sort of iridescent green and blue and a bit of purple and a bit of yellow. And the female, who unfortunately was not blessed with such gorgeous coloration. Unfortunately, in the birds, that tends to be how it goes, unlike in the humans. Right, that's the white-bellied sunbird, Cinyrus talatala. I just read that now, I didn't actually know it. Cinyrus talatala, particularly useless piece of information, but it does help to warm the lips on a chilly morning. Not that it's freezing. Right, here we go. Thanks, Molly. So, lovely to be out first before anybody else is out, and we're going to drive down the road and make sure that we drive slowly and keep an eye on the road, because it's like the newspaper of the morning, basically. It tells us exactly what happened during the night, and it's our job to try and interpret the marks and signs in the sand. Tracking is an extremely important part of what we do. And in all sort of conservation efforts, be they tourism, anti-poaching, or land management, or any other kind, the tracking aspect of it is very important. And the people of this area, the Shangaan people, who are the locals of the area, are renowned in the country for being expert trackers, especially in this sort of environment. Neither Bryan and I are a Shangaan, but we do our best. Definitely feel the temperature dropping as we go down into the dip here. I'd say it drops at least sort of 4 or 5 degrees. At this stage, no tracks on the lions coming across. I know that there are people looking for them in the north where they were seen yesterday, but they seem to have disappeared. Now, that's not actually true. They definitely haven't disappeared, but sometimes the tracking of them can be a little difficult. The best approach, of course, would be to find the tracks and then go in on foot if you don't bump into them in the car. And contrary to what you might think, tracking 5 male lions on foot is actually not a particularly life-threatening situation. When they're young and they're not territorial yet, they tend to be very nervous of people on foot. And I remember the very first time when my trainer walked me, they decided we had to see lions on foot. And I carried the rifle, which I thought was pretty suicidal of everyone concerned because I was so clueless at the time. We took the man who turned, who I then worked with for many years, called Elvis. And Elvis sort of tracked the lions into some thick mapani. It was four young males. And we tracked them in there. And my heartbeat, of course, was racing. I was convinced that we were going to have to stand down an enormous charge from these four big kings of the jungle. I'd never seen a lion on foot before. And we walked through this very thick bush. The birds were sort of silent. And Elvis spotted them first, long before I did. And he just went, duck. And they got up, all four of them, and hightailed it out of there so fast that all I saw was the flick of two tails. And that was my first experience with lions on foot. They're not nearly as terrifying as you might think. Lovely as the air warms up as we go up. Hello, Deb, on Twitter. You are tweeting early in the morning like some of the birds out here. You say that you have read that there are lions being taken from South Africa and put into sort of to recolonize. Ooh, look at that. That is the sun. I'll try and get a nice picture of it. Deb, to recolonize game reserves in Rwanda, it's well possible. I haven't read about it myself, but they are doing. Bryan, has this worked for you or not? They're certainly not taking them from here. I suspect they're taking them from breeding facilities. Say when? Back a bit. So we're just going to have a look at the glorious sun that's just popped up. So Deb, not from here, but it's not an uncommon thing for them to take it. Lions, probably from private reserves. You see what happens if you have a private reserve that's not, oh, look at that. That's not part of an open system. Lion populations, then you have to manage quite carefully because you can't have too many and you've got to avoid inbreeding and that sort of thing. So it's well possible that some of the smaller private reserves that have little lion populations that they need to manage could be exporting some of them to Rwanda. And that would be extremely exciting. I'd love to see a lion in Rwanda. In fact, I'd love to go to Rwanda and see the gorillas and the chimps that they have knocking about there. Remarkable success story that some kudu going across the road. Remarkable success story that that Rwandan tourism industry, from their horrific time in 1994 to where they are now, is A lot of that regeneration is to do with the fact that they have managed to sort out tourism so effectively. Marked contrast to their Burundian neighbors. Just going to stop here. There's some kudu, unfortunately, not being particularly confiding to us. Terry in Santa Ana. This sounds like a nice place to live. Terry, you want to know if you often hear about endangered animals, and are there any endangered animals or birds in South Africa? There are quite a few, actually. And we see a couple when we fly around here. We don't fly around here. The birds fly around here when we drive around here. One of them is the saddle-billed stork. They're pretty endangered, not very healthy populations. The battelier, which is fairly common around here, is threatened because of it can't live outside of protected areas. There are various vulture species that we see, one of them called the Cape vulture, which looks like the sort of bog-standard white-backed variety that we get mostly in here, which isn't endangered. And they come in from the cliffs of the Drakensberg to the west of us, and they're endangered. So there are quite a few endangered birds, yeah. And I must just clear something up. The other day, somebody asked a great question. I think it was Edward, who tends to ask ornithologically based questions. I said that there were I didn't know how many endemic bird species there were in the Kruger Park, but I estimated it. The number at around 20, which it turns out was a gross overestimation. There are no endemic species to the Kruger Park. Now, if you don't know what an endemic species is, it means a species that only occurs here. So of the 520 odd birds that occur in the Kruger National Park, none of them only occur in the Kruger National Park. And that's because the habitat that we have here is not unique to this area. So in a place like the Western Cape, for example, where there is a unique habitat of something called fynbos, there'll be a number of endemic birds. But the Kruger National Park, because it's not a unique habitat and doesn't contain any particularly unique vegetation types that don't occur north of us or east of us or west of us, there are no endemic bird species in the Kruger, but a huge list and great variety of wonderful birds. Right. The immobilizer off. It's an abiding mystery of working out here that this vehicle has an immobilizer. For those of you who perhaps don't know what an immobilizer is, it's a special sort of computerized device in the engine that you have to have a special button for to stop. And so if you are bent on Grand Theft Auto, an immobilizer is a fairly effective way of stopping that. Not a lot of Grand Theft Auto out here, thankfully. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Misty sunrise. Atmosphere of expectation. You may lose us briefly. We're going through a dip. BJ, nice question. How cold does it have to get here before the reptiles, such as the chameleons, might start to die because of the cold, of cold stress? BJ, I would suspect it would have to get quite a lot colder than it actually does get here. At the very minimum, the temperature will drop to probably maybe zero once a year, maybe. But probably 4 degrees is as cold as it'll get. And the reptiles will just go into a sort of state of torpor. If the temperature dropped below zero, I imagine they'd probably get into a bit of trouble. But I think once or twice to zero, they'll be fine. So I would postulate that below zero, the reptiles will be in trouble. Nice question. Remember, it doesn't ever get cold enough here for the reptiles to go into permanent hibernation even. So they will kind of slow down during the winter, but you often find snake tracks on the road during the winter, more than you do in the summer. So they'll come out and bask in the sun on the lovely winter's days that we have. The other thing I was hoping to find today, which I didn't find yesterday, was some elephants. And so far, no tracks of elephants or lions. But we will keep up the search stoically. A lovely update from Matt in Texas. Thanks, Matt. Matt has just confirmed that they are taking some lions, 5 lionesses and 2 males from parks in Kruger in KwaZulu-Natal, their parks tend to be a bit more fragmented there, and so it's exactly as I said, they need to do various sort of lion management, and so they're taking them to Akagera Park in Rwanda. That's really exciting news. Thanks, Matt. Turn off right here to see if we can't, if there's anything going on at Buffelshoek Dam. Question from Rather in Tucson, Arizona. Right. You want to know, what do I think is the most dangerous cat in the world for a human one-on-one? I must just say, Rather, that I don't consider any cats inherently dangerous at all. There are many cats that are potentially dangerous, but none that are inherently dangerous. But I would say that the cat that I would most not like to come up against one-on-one on foot would probably be a tiger. They, I think, tend to be slightly less afraid of human beings than lions and leopards and the cats that we get out here. But of the big cats, probably a tiger is the one that I would be most worried about. Here on the dam wall and get a picture of glorious sunrise. You happy here, Bryan? Look at that. Sorry. And we're just sitting here at Buffelshoek Dam. We're just going to have a listen for the next few seconds. So what you can hear is the Franklin's calling all over the place. Here, a little long-billed crombeck going. You hear that, Bryan?
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's mainly little groups of Franklin, little coveys of Franklin, dotted about all the way, 360 degrees, calling some doves. And a white-breasted cormorant who seems to live here not a common resident at all in this area. And he's just holding his wings out that so that the filaments of his feathers realign. Swimming around tends to sort of, I think it misaligns their feathers, and they, because they swim underwater, they'll swim like ducks for a while and then they dive under the water to try and catch fish and frogs and various other things. And that process of sort of swimming tends to misalign their filaments. Vultures do the same thing. After a lengthy day of hanging in the air, they'll come and sit down on a dead tree, look ominous, and then hang their wings out so that the filaments can realign. And you can just see my old friend, the bachelor of Buffelshoek there. That's the hippopotamus that Bryan was looking at earlier. And he is alone in the world. And while we look at this marvelous hippopotamus, we're going to go across to Scott, who is exploring the wilderness. I'm not sure if he's on any tracks, but he'll tell you all of that, and we'll see you a little bit later.
Welcome back, everyone, and I'm sure you've been having a good time with James, and I certainly agree. I think a tiger is going to be the last big cat you would want to have an arm wrestle with. They are far larger than any of the other big cats around the world, and they are known to become man-eaters, and that would be a very, very scary scenario to be in. We haven't had a great deal of luck. We came across a set of male leopard tracks, but they, very shortly after we found them, they disappeared off the road. And it was in an area with big blocks, with not many roads, so we decided to carry on. We drove through in the general direction that his tracks were heading in, but didn't have any further luck. Other than that, we've just been fighting the cold, but the sun is rising up and we'll soon be getting a little bit warmer. I've just got a report on the radio from Aubrey. He has found tracks of Shadow and Sindile, a 12-month-old cub, and they're currently on the boundary between Juma and Arethusa. So we're going to make our way into that general area and see if we have any luck with them. I'm not sure if James mentioned, but the Inkahuma pride have been found in Buffelshoek with one of the Matimba coalition, and it sounds like they've made a kill. I'm not sure exactly what they've killed, but good to know that the Inkahuma pride, as well as one Matimba male, are having a feast. Sadly though, it's not in an area where we can go. There's been no word of the Birmingham boys yet, a coalition of five young males that were close to our northern boundary. So hopefully we'll get some further intel as to where they could have gone last night. But at least they did move closer towards us here at Juma, and maybe in the next couple of weeks or days we could get a surprise visit from them. The tricky thing is the Birmingham boys are almost specialized buffalo hunters. In December last year, they killed three buffalo within a space of about 48 hours. So in about 2 days, they killed three buffalo. And they've got a lot of size and strength, which makes taking down large prey like buffalo a little bit easier for them. And that's a big reason why they may also be spending a lot of time in the Manyaleti to the north of us now. The Manyaleti has a lot more open grasslands, and that allows for large herds of buffalo to exist there. And the lion follow the buffalo. Or at least in this case they do. James was talking about reptiles hibernating in this cold weather, and it appears like just about everything's hibernating, not just the reptiles. There hasn't been too much, at least on the roads that we've been driving this morning. It can go like that, and that's not to say that as we arrive here at Treehouse Dam we won't get lucky. Scenery, and because there's not a breath of wind this morning, there are some beautiful reflections here on the water at Treehouse Dam. Jenny's interested to know, when will the landowners decide to pump water into any of the waterholes that they can? Because she's noticed the Juma waterhole is very low. It's a good question. I don't have a clue when they will start to pump, though. I haven't been here through a dry season, so I've got no history with the Juma and Arethusa landowners during a dry period. But I'm sure, in all likelihood, before it completely dries up, they'll decide to start pumping some water into the Juma waterhole, which is an option that can be pumped into. But this dam here, and I think twin dams, another waterhole not far from here, those don't have the ability to be pumped with water. It's important to remember that all of these waterholes are essentially added bonuses. They are man-made, and therefore the animals, it's a tricky one, because the animals that now live here have become accustomed to these waterholes, but before we arrived as humans, there was no waterholes here, and there were still wild animals existing with no concern. So It's not necessarily a very good thing to have too many waterholes, man-made dams, on any wilderness area, but it does depend. It's a very interesting debate to have, and people will have varied opinions, but the bottom line is these aren't supposed to be here, so it's not a major issue if and when they dry up. Animals can move to other water sources, natural water sources. The sable antelope, which we don't see in the Sabi Sands unless it's a very rare encounter, used to be prolific in this area, so much so that they were actually shot for rations for staff to feed on. That is how many there were. And since waterholes were put in place, that's a big reason why their numbers have dwindled, because they're an antelope that doesn't rely on water. And as soon as all these, as soon as waterholes are put into an area, it allows other animals to come into that area that naturally weren't spending time there. And because more herbivores came into this area, more predators may have come in, and therefore the sable would have had a higher predator concentration to deal with. So it's just an interesting history of the Sabi Sands and how the waterholes may have had a negative effect, at least for one species. But for the greater good of all the animals, it's, I think, a good thing. As you can see, the animals that we view on a daily basis have got healthy numbers. It's a natural ecosystem, other than a few minor man-made differences. So it's also one last thing to finish off the subject, is that even though we are part of a great ecosystem and a huge ecosystem, part of the Greater Kruger National Park, there are fences around the reserve, and as soon as a fence is put around any natural area, there will need to be some level of human interference and management of that area. So it's a tricky one, but we don't have to worry about anything, Jenny. The animals will be fine, other than possibly a few fish that may lose their home. But what is important to remember is that the death of any one animal may make a huge difference to another animal surviving. maybe a much-needed meal for a predator, be it a bird of prey or a young leopard that's hungry, could feed on a fish from a drying-up waterhole. So it's not a problem if all of the waterholes dried up. It's a natural flow. Drought is a natural thing, and it needs to happen every now and then to balance out populations. The herbivores will obviously be an animal that battles during the dry season, and the carnivores may flourish. Notice that we are no longer seeing as many monitor lizards around the water holes, the water monitors, and she's wondering if they hole up during the winter. They are still around. I have still seen a few, but not since I've been back. They'll probably be a little bit less active and probably lie up a lot. So it's not that they're necessarily in holes, but they may be basking in the summer. They often actually climb trees and seek refuge in trees. So they're not necessarily in holes, the water monitor lizards, but the rock monitor lizards could very well be in the cavities of trees. So out of the two different monitors, they'll have slightly different plans or hiding places during the winter, but the monitors will still be active. It's still warm enough during the day for reptiles to warm up their cold-blooded systems and move around. And it's important to remember that a lot of the snakes will mate during our winter, so it's not that they become completely inactive, all of them, and go to sleep for 6 months. It's often just a slower rate of living and less movement than normal. To have you with us. PK is interested to know about the sable antelope that I spoke about a few minutes ago. So what I will do is I will get my little book out and show you a picture and a bit more information on this beautiful beast. They still occur in the Kruger National Park in drier areas. Like I say, they prefer dry areas and can travel up to about 60 kilometers, which is probably around 40 miles, in order to find their prey, find water. Well, this is bizarre. I cannot find sable in the index, so I'll just have to flip through in the hope that we stumble across them. Well, this is a little bit embarrassing, but at least Wium is showing you the trees in the meantime. How on earth could it not be in... Oh, there we go. Okay. PK was interested to know how big the sable antelope was. And I'll show you a picture first. They are on average around 400 pounds, but can be a little bit bigger than that. Here in the book it says anywhere from 180 to 270 kilograms. So quite large. You could almost say a similar size to Kudu, And they've got these beautiful horns that curl back. The males are black, and the females are this lighter shade of brown. And there's a very small picture at the top of the page here where it gives you a comparison to an average size man compared to the sable. So that also gives you a good idea of the size. So that's the sable antelope. They are still about. Brent actually saw one on his way to collect us when I returned from leave, Nikki and myself, and he saw one in the Manyaleti Game Reserve further north of us, so not too far away, and he was very happy to have seen one. You don't get to see them very often. And Wium was with him, who's on camera today, so the two of them got to see that. Well, we're getting fairly close to the area where we may find some sign of shadow and a cub. Focused, keep your eyes peeled, and hopefully one of you will spot the animal before we do. It's yet to happen, but I know it's going to, and I can't wait for that day when we get stopped by you guys and told to reverse because we've driven past a leopard or anything of interest, really. So I challenge you to that this morning. Good places to look are on the horizontal branches of the marula trees, which are just skeletons at the moment, and also up on termite mounds like this one up ahead here. That would be a perfect place for a leopard to be sunning itself. Some buffalo up ahead. Lisa, and welcome on board. Lisa is wanting to know if we get an insect called a cicada here in our wet season, and yes, we certainly do. They make a serious racket, but now they are quiet. Apparently in Arizona they are beginning to hatch, so good luck with all the noise they make. And let's take a close look at these buffalo. The individual that Wium's filming now appears to be blind in its right eye. I saw it was very white in color, and I hope it looks back at us so that you can see that. This could well be the same bachelor herd of buffalo that we saw walking past the hyena den site yesterday afternoon. They're all very focused at the task at hand, which is evidently grazing. You'll notice a few small birds on the buffalo's back. I'm just going to creep forward a little bit so we get a bit closer to them for you. Oh, there goes one. Now we're nice and close. And you should get some beautiful views of these little oxpeckers. You get two types of oxpeckers that will feed on buffalo, the red-billed and the yellow-billed. But we only really get to see the red-billed here. Occasionally we may get lucky and see their slightly bigger cousin, the yellow-billed. And as you can see, they're basking on the back of the buffalo like a solar panel while he goes about feeding. So they're not quite ready for breakfast yet. They're happy to warm up and probably try and look for some parasites to feed on a little bit later. You'll notice a big scar missing out of that marula tree, and that could be from elephant. Elephant will pry bark off marula trees. It's doesn't strip off as easily as it does on a knobthorn tree, for example. So you often just see these chunks that have been pried off. And if there wasn't a buffalo standing there, I would show you. Basically, if VM pans a little bit lower down, you can see a prominent scratch kind of from left to right from that central white stripe. And that's probably where the tusk of the elephant's pried off this external layer of bark. But that's going to cause no damage to this tree, just a little bit of a flesh wound. If, for example, that... Hang on, what's going on here? I'm not sure what's going on. There's some fork-tailed drongos having... I've been chatting a little bit, and they're probably just feeding on the parasites or the insects that the buffalo chase up as they move through the bush. But I noticed all the buffalo kind of stopped simultaneously and now are almost moving with a little bit more urgency. So I'm wondering what caused that. Anyway, maybe they've got wind of some danger in the area. But there's nothing evident to us. Well, we've got a question from Chris Rogue Cropper. And she's interested to know, are these the same buffalo that we saw being chased by the Inkahuma pride a few days ago? I don't think so, Chris. I can see a few more buffalo deeper into this vegetation where they've all moved. And it's a larger bachelor herd than the one that was chased by the Inkahumas. So I don't think so, but what I can assure you is that they all would have been chased by a different lion. Many, many times. It's a fact that I often wish we could know how many times any given buffalo has been chased by a lion, because as you would know, a lot of the time the predators fail in their hunts, so it would be nice to know how many times the buffaloes get away before finally possibly one day being caught. Okay. This is really interesting. Take a look here. There's a young Steenbok nursing. You can see the father is approaching. This is something that we very seldom get to share with you, these kinds of moments. And it looked like the male may have other intentions. notice how the male's lifting up his front leg in order to try and seduce the female. And he's rubbing his leg between her back legs, all while their kid is having a drink. And they do form pairs, monogamous pairs, these little steenbok. Oh. One happy family. It does make sense for him to be trying to mate with the female now, because it's time to start getting ready for the next generation. The youngster clearly hasn't had enough to drink, and the mother's trying to run away and prevents it from drinking anymore. It looks quite big to still be drinking, that youngster. So it's probably in the process of getting weaned off. Great. Well, from the mighty Cape buffalo to those tiny little steenbok, they're probably only about knee high and probably weigh around 10 kilograms or so, 20 pounds, so a lot smaller than the Cape buffalo. And very cute to see that youngster nursing. Well, we're gonna continue. We're approaching the boundary with Arethusa. There's a chance we could head into Arethusa. I'm just gonna get an update from the guys on the radio now. And while we do that, we will send you back to James, and he can update you on how his morning's been coming along. We'll see you later.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Jiga. You find Bryan and I in a state of some excitement. We come across some male leopard tracks. They look to me to be very fresh. We followed them from the eastern boundary, down one of the roads, through the block here. He popped out on the road just back there, and he's come along here. And his tracks are going along the road. So we're going to carry on along here with you in tow. Help us spot him, hopefully. With any luck, he'll be just wandering the road in front of us. I suspect these tracks are from early this morning. They could be quite recent. It doesn't look like anything else is on top of them, which is very encouraging. So we're going to carry on along the road and wish us luck. These gloves are becoming ridiculous. Okay. So the tracks go dead along the road, and as you probably all know by now, leopards will generally like to move on the road because they can avoid the wet grass and shaking out their feet like cats do when they get wet. He doesn't seem to be going down there. Let's just keep an eye out. Bryan, is he your side? No, here he is. No, that's not him. Can you see him there? Bryan watches the left and I watch the right. You got him there? Brilliant. So he's on the left-hand side of the road. So far. I can still see him there. Very important to keep an eye out, of course. Not just on the road. They don't often walk in the most predictable fashion, especially if they're hunting. Now, I think that where we are, the male leopard is probably in Bula. This is his sort of area, or one of his areas. Well, I don't see him anymore. Bryan, have you got him there? Let's just go to the next sandy patch. It's a bit difficult here. Look, my side, he's not on my side. Have a look there, Bryan.
Not seeing him. Okay. So, we'll just go a little bit forward. Yeah. So he's not on the road anymore.
So, he may be right next to the road, and we may have driven past him. So we're just going to go back to where we had the last tracks, and then we see what and how and if.
Tom, a lovely question and a lovely topic. You've seen a video of a leopard that has killed a baboon and then sort of adopted the youngster. Tom, I've seen a number of videos like that. I've never seen it live myself. I've seen it with lions on video. I've seen it with leopard. And it's an amazingly odd behavior. There was that lioness who many years ago adopted a number of oryx babies. And actually kidnapped them from their mothers, and she would look after them and live with them. And I think on the odd occasion she did actually eventually eat them, but it's a bizarre behavior, kind of overriding motherly instinct. I'm just keeping an eye out here. Are some elephant tracks too, which is very nice. Bryan, you keep an eye out off the road if you don't mind. So it's round about here that Bryan and I had the last tracks. So he is going down the road here. Right. Now the trick is to find out which direction he's turned to. Given where he was coming from, the most likely direction I suspect is to the west, which is encouraging. So, if you're a leopard and you're walking along a road like this, what you're probably doing is you're marking territory, and you're also keeping an eye out for whatever you can see, which might turn into a nice meal. Now, what you may well do, a little bit of a path that goes through there, what you may well do is spot something, and you'll then go into stalk mode. And then it becomes almost impossible to try and track because, first of all, they go off the road into the grass and it becomes almost impossible to see where the tracks have gone. And they will start to move in an irregular fashion, going from bush to bush, bits of cover to bits of cover. Whereas when they're territorial marking, they tend to walk in a fairly steady, straight line. We're just going to listen briefly and see if we can't hear anything in the way of alarm calls. Birds. Or squirrels. You can hear a pearl-spotted owl. Birds or squirrels will often give leopards away. And the tracks seem to be from this morning sometime. Nothing else on top of them. Alright, so we're going to drive very gingerly forward and see if we can't find where they've gone off the road. Otherwise, we'll do a loop around the block. Plenty of other white-tailed mongoose tracks and that sort of thing.
If I find you a decent leopard track, I will show you what I'm looking at, what I'm looking for. Scott also had some tracks around about this area this morning, and I'm just going to get hold of him and find out where they went. Scott, do you copy, Scott? Scott, do you copy, Scott? Hello, Scott. I believe you had some male leopard tracks this morning on Central Road. Okay, copy. Thanks very much. Did they look pretty fresh to you? So Scott did have male leopard tracks pretty much in this area, and he has moved on to other things. So we'll go to where he last had them, and then we'll follow from there. So somewhere around here, there is a male leopard. So we'll go to the next junction, which is where Scott found them. Some nice questions from Junebug and Purple Rain. In a state of some distress at the lack of elephants that we're finding at the moment. Junebug, and I think it was here that Scott had them. Junebug and Purple Rain, the elephants are not around. I promise they are around, but as the winter progresses, remember, the water concentrates, and so they will go from waterhole to waterhole. But we're in a vast area where there are the places that we can't go, and what you'll find is that the herds concentrate, so they're not quite as widely spread. And they'll be on an area for a while, and then they'll disappear for a while during the winter months. And that's just unfortunately how it goes. But they are around. In California, just on the topic of water again, I'm just going to turn around here. I don't think the tracks are going to pop out here. Hang on a second. As I say that, no, that's a hyena. Marge, you want to know, do we use windmills to pump for water or wind pumps? Yes, we do sometimes, not in this particular area. But the Kruger National Park has got a number, and certainly Arethusa, which is the property or the reserve to the west of us, absolutely uses or used to, has got a number of old wind pumps that they used to use. They don't give a particularly great wilderness feel, you know, when you're driving along through the untrammeled African wild, and out pops the wind pump. Brian, did you see something back there that arrested your attention, sir?
Very suspicious looking.
Ah. Bryan saw a leopard-shaped termite mound. Right. So this is basically where Scott saw the tracks. Keeping our eyes peeled. Hello, Connor in Denver. I've actually been to Denver. You want to know if the man-made waterholes ever attract crocodiles? Connor, they do, if they're big enough. We're quite close to a river here called the Sand River, probably about 3 kilometers as the crow flies. So, you know, that's where most of the crocs of the area will hang out. But absolutely every so often they will come into these waterholes, especially if they're moving between the two. But I think the ones that we have here on Juma specifically are probably a little bit small for the crocodiles. But that's not to ever say that they won't be around. And so it would be extremely foolish to go thinking that if you can't see a crocodile, that he isn't there. Because many people have ended up at the bottom of rivers and dams with that being the last thought on their minds. No longer see the tracks of this leopard, so we'll start looping the block and hope he pops out at some stage. Lots of little francolins around. Female from yesterday. I'm just going to go back up this way. Doug in California, nice question. You've seen that you can do mountain bike safaris in Africa, and would we do them here? Doug, I've ridden a bicycle through an area like this. It's because it's so thick in some areas, I don't believe it to be the most intelligent option for modes of transport in this area, but you can do it. Lions tend to, if you see lions on a bicycle, you get off the bike and then you walk backwards, hopefully. They will tend to be attracted by the spinning wheels. And so, yeah, not a great idea in a particular area like this. Elephants, yeah, they sometimes aren't particular fans, but they've done rides through the Kruger Park before. They've got slightly wider roads there in the Kruger, and I suspect they sent vehicles on in front. But it's not a bad idea, you just got to be really aware. North of our borders, in a place called the Thule Block, they do run quite a few bicycle safaris, and they work quite nicely because the Thule Block's more open, and so you can see further. And if you're riding a bicycle at great speed, you want to be able to see exactly what's going on. Cycle races through areas like this, I would say, would be verging on insane. Hyena. So we're just going to drive, we're now coming back onto the eastern border. We're just going to drive up here to check that he didn't come through. question. You want to know how many bones there are in hyena dung? Well, Lisa, if I find some hyena dung, I will break it up for you and we'll have a look. I'm not sure we'll be able to gauge how many bones there were in it, though, because it'll mostly be a fairly noxious paste that we'll find. Interestingly, hyena dung is not white when it comes out. When it arrives in the world, hyena dung is green. And because of the oxidation of the calcium in the dung, it goes white very quickly. So for those of you who perhaps haven't seen it, hyena dung, when you see it around the place, is normally white. And it's they use the sort of white markings to demarcate their territories. So we're just driving slowly up the eastern boundary here, trying to find some sort of sign of Mbula tracks. Okay, we're just going to nip across to Scott. He is on Arethusa, terra incognito to the west, and while we carry on trying to find these leopard tracks, over to him.
Welcome back, everyone. And what a beautiful Nyala bull this is. There's a number of fork-tailed drongos following him. And the reason why you can see them flying around him is because he'll be chasing up insects, just like the fork-tailed drongos that were trailing behind the buffalo. There's also an oxpecker that's trying to jump on board to try and get some parasites off it. They are such awesome antelope, and this is a perfect open clearing to be viewing him in. He's a beautiful big bull in his prime, and he's about to walk past a tree where we saw Sindile, Shadow's cub, just before I went on leave a few weeks ago. It's an absolutely beautiful morning here, and we're on Arethusa. We did have some tracks of Sindile, a young male leopard, and his mother. They were moving together, but then their tracks veered off the road. So now we're just looping around the area in the hope that we may find exactly where they've gone. I believe you've been chatting about mountain bike safaris, and at the lodge where I used to work in the Sabi Sands, we would offer mountain biking to our guests if they would like to between drives. Oh, this is a really pretty bird. Please don't fly away. It's tiny, so we're going to rely on the zoom to try and get you up close and personal with it. It's a little emerald spotted wood dove, and you'll notice those little windows that glisten an emerald green when the sun catches them on its wings. And it's busy going about looking for little grass seeds. As I was saying though, at the lodge in the Sabi Sands where I used to work, we would offer mountain biking to guests. It's good fun, but it is quite dangerous in that because you are moving silently or relatively quietly, and also quite quickly at stages, you can move quickly, you can get yourself into trouble and startle animals without them knowing you're arriving, and that can lead to trouble. Although at that lodge there were no issues, and I believe they still continue to do mountain biking. We would just drive along the roads though, mainly, not really off-road. I can hear some elephants screaming behind us, so we're going to head in that direction. just faint. Sounded quite far away, but it was somewhere in this direction, and there's not many elephants around at the moment, so it'll be great if we can find them. And you would have noticed a strange little cement structure that we just drove past there. That's a fire pit for Arethusa when they have their bush dinners. Quite a few of the lodges in the Sabi Sands will set up a beautiful dinner out under the stars, and you arrive straight from game drive into dinner that's been cooked over the coals, and it's a lot of fun, and that's why you would have seen that little structure there. Glimpse of a zebra up ahead, so even if we don't find the elephants that were making a lot of trumpeting in this direction, there should be some zebras in shot shortly. But it is quite thick here, so I'm not sure how easy it's going to be to film. Just get its rump disappearing. Oh. Well, I guess our timing was not the best for the zebra sighting. All we've seen is the rear end and a quick toilet break, and off he goes. So that's what he thought about our plans. Huh. Maybe next time. There's a small waterhole nearby, and maybe we will find the elephants there. Although I can see all these zebra continuing in that direction, so maybe we'll get to see the zebras drinking. Or at least a better view of them. And we might get a fleeting glimpse of them trotting across the road here. Perfect golden sunshine. I'm guessing they are moving from one open area to another, and that's why they're not going to be hanging around too much, because they are specifically grazers that feed on grass. They will often move from grassy clearing to grassy clearing in search of good feeding. And they don't feel particularly safe in thick bush, and rightfully so. There's a lot more hiding places for predators to ambush them. We've got an interesting question from Deb, and Deb's interested to know where they offer horseback safaris, which they do in several places within Africa, or quite a few places in Africa, Do the predators not confuse the horses with zebra and therefore make it a dangerous business to be on a horseback safari? They don't, Deb, and the reason why is because there's a human sitting on the back. So as soon as there's a human involved, the animals will know that. And what it means, oh, here the zebra go again. And what it also means is that we can control horses. And even if it was a zebra that we were riding, if we got the zebra to hold its ground and confront the lion's natural instinct to chase fleeing prey would not be triggered because the prey would not run away. And I've seen some incredible videos of horseback safaris in East Africa where they ride the horses very close up to lion and they don't have any problem. The key, I guess, in this whole thing is that you need to have faith in controlling your horse, because if your horse was to start running, like I said, could trigger that reflex for the lion to start chasing. So as long as you prevent that happening, you should be okay. And what a great way to explore Africa from the back of a horse. It often also allows you to get in and amongst herds of animals as if you're not even there. So it can be really great for game viewing and for an experience. Okay, well, I've just seen some elephant tracks. So maybe they are the same animals that we heard earlier. They appear to be heading in the same direction that we're going in. So we could get lucky. The audio did sound quite far away though, so it's a bit of a gamble. Close to us, but the place that the zebra are going is in the same direction we're going, and we keep intersecting them. But we'll leave them to continue now. Just seeing some leopard tracks here. I'm just going to jump out to assess how fresh they are. Obviously not very fresh because I've only seen one track and it must be in between where the vehicles are driving at this intersection. And if we were to see more tracks, then we'd know that the leopard has moved on top of the vehicle tracks. But because I've only seen one in the sense of the road, it is indicative of an older track. So sadly no luck there. But still nice to know that a leopard was walking down this road not too long ago. We're a few days late. I'm trying to now find this track to show you. Well, I think the track that I did see, I may have driven over shortly after seeing it, so now I can't even show you the track that I saw. Apologies for that. Come on, elephants, where are you hiding? morning, Susan from Long Island, New York. And Susan would like to know if there are any tuskers, big elephant bulls here on Juma. Sadly, not at the moment. And we actually very seldomly get big tuskers in the Sabi Sands. There are a number of them that live within the Kruger National Park, so they have the ability to come and visit us here. But I have yet to see any monster bulls in the sands in the 4+ years that I've spent here. But not too far away in different parts of Kruger, you do get some massive bulls whose tusks will touch the ground. Hard to believe, but there are still a few monsters out there. It's interesting, I'm not sure why we don't get those bulls naturally coming into the Sabi Sands, but maybe it's just bad luck. There's not many of them, and maybe they simply just prefer other areas because of no other reason than their personal tastes and opinions. We do get other elephant bulls coming here, so there's nothing stopping a large tusker being seen here, but it doesn't happen often. Interestingly enough, with big elephant bulls, you get some whose tusks become so long that they actually break off because they drag along the ground so much that they actually, you could almost say, become a nuisance. And will a lot of the time, the big tuskers, one tusk may break off and then the other may break off a few years later, or whatever the case may be. But you have fairly often these large tuskers whose tusks will snap off because they're so long. It can be quite useful for them because they can also use it as a pillow. They just lower their chin ever so slightly and they've got their head perfectly suspended by their tusks. It can be handy, I guess, to a degree when it comes to sleeping, but general moving around and feeding could be, you could imagine, quite tricky with these massive tusks. It's also must be quite tiring carrying them around day in and day out. Leslie in California. Leslie's interested to know what the scenario is with elephant culling, because she's heard that there is an abundance of elephants in the Kruger National Park. And yes, there is a healthy population of elephants at the moment. And even though they used to cull them as a measure to control population, they no longer do that. And what they're trying to do is to, by using waterholes, they will actively pump one waterhole, and we just chatted about this morning, so it's great to touch on it again. They can create scenarios where elephants will move into an area because there's water there, but then possibly not keep the water there for too long so that you keep the elephants moving. If elephants are allowed the benefits of being able to stay in one place because they don't have to move for water, that will mean they will cause too much damage on the vegetation in that given area without moving. So with waterhole management, they are trying to curb the effects of large elephant numbers. It also means that because they have to move bigger distances and have less favorable living conditions, more realistic living conditions, their population doesn't grow too quickly. Whereas if elephants or any animal are given a very easy and luxurious life, here's a lot of dung in elephant signs, speaking of these elephants, and these could have been the ones that we heard this morning. You can see some branches on our right here, as well as some elephant dung. Sadly, I flattened some, but you can see a little bit in the bottom of your screen. It's from a small elephant. A large elephant will have a much larger bolus, almost the size of a soccer ball. And then as Wium pans up a bit, you'll see the branches of a weeping wattle that they've stripped the bark off. So they weren't interested in the leaves, simply the bark. And these tracks look nice and fresh. Like I said, it could be from the elephant that we heard trumpeting this morning. Where have they gone? That is the next question. We'll continue. The tracks look like they could well be heading in the same direction that we're going in. As I was saying though, with any animal, if conditions become highly favorable, reproduction rates will increase. And because there were a lot of waterholes artificially placed in the Kruger National Park many years ago, it was believed that it was a good thing. Now they've realized that it's better to have less and also to manage the few waterholes that have been put in place. And since they've been managing them more effectively, they've noticed that elephant populations are not rising as fast as they used to, which is good. And that way we don't have to come in and cull them. Elephant culling is a very brutal business and there's no nice way to do it. Sadly, you can't pick off one or two of the older members of a herd. You have to wipe out an entire herd at a time, from the smallest to the biggest. And even though the conservationists involved in that will feel very strongly that what they're doing is correct to keep elephant populations at a correct number or a sustainable number, imagine having to be the person to do that. It must be absolutely terrible. So, thankfully, that is not the case. And I'm just going to move this buffalo thorn tree out the way here. Cleaning up after our exterior decorating team. That wasn't the best position decoration. So, sadly the elephants will have to rethink that little plan that they had. Austin, hello. Kevin would like to know what would happen if we were to wear bright fluorescent orange clothing. And not the neutral colors that we are wearing. Probably nothing, to be honest, Kevin. It would just be an eyesore, really. And I personally don't think that wearing brightly colored clothes will have any effect on these animals within the Sabi Sands. You often see some of the tourists and guests who come here wearing quite ridiculous outfits, and it has no negative effect. And if you think about it from the animal's perspective, the predators, for example, don't see well in color. Excuse me. So they're only seeing in shades of grey and black and white, really. So it's going to have no impact on most of the predators or nocturnal animals. And in terms of your daytime animals, you could wear bright orange clothing but in a camouflage pattern that could still help you to creep up on kudu or elephants or any animals like that. So I don't think it would have any adverse effects other than looking very out of place. interesting update from Billy Joe. And Billy Joe has noticed or seen quite recently some pictures of a massive African rock python that was found dead with a porcupine stuck in its belly. And it had made a massive, massive kill. It was a 12 and a half kilogram porcupine, apparently, that it had swallowed. Now, swallowing it would have been relatively easy because snakes will swallow their prey head first, meaning the quills would have slid in to its mouth quite easily. However, obviously, when it got into the stomach, the quills somehow got lodged in the intestines and caused that unfortunate python to die. So it was cut open, and then the porcupine was revealed because they wanted to get to the bottom of how the snake died. And isn't that really, really interesting? I mean, the mere fact that the python did catch and kill a porcupine is quite a surprise, and then that it ended up dying because of it is also very, very interesting. Yeah, I did actually see pictures on that, and what I love about being out here in Africa is that even though you may have your general trends of what may happen and what animals, certain animals may prey on, you always get these bizarre scenarios that keep us guessing. So thanks for sharing that with all of us, and we're gonna you back to James to get an update from him, and we're going to continue searching for anything of interest out here. The elephants seem to have disappeared. We'll see you all a little bit later.
Hello everybody, welcome back to Jiga. We have failed to find the leopard. He has, I think, headed south into this enormous block to my right-hand side. But we've just stopped here to bask a little bit in the lovely warmth of the now warming sun and in the company of a little couple of Nyalas. And you can see how beautifully they sexually dimorphic they are. That's a young cow behind this bull. And the bull now thinks he's hiding from us. Just beautiful antelope. And I must tell you, as I stopped here, I was feeling a sense of frustration at being unable to sort of directly track Mvula. And as I stopped, I just felt the warmth of the new sun shining on my face, and I thought, ah, all is well with the world. We'll just wait here and see if the Nyala doesn't pop out. Otherwise, we'll drive around to see if we can't get a better view of him. Question about whether how you differentiate them when they're youngsters, Nyalas. It's difficult. You need to look behind their tails, basically, and then you can tell. But without, in the absence of that, when they're youngsters, it's really quite difficult to tell if they are male or female. I'm just going to move slightly and see if we can't get a better view. Out there, and if you look carefully on his face, we'll try and get in close and see. They tend to walk nice and slowly like this. You can see he's got a white stripe between his eyes, and there are some various fangled theories for why he's got them. See how lovely and slowly he walks. with his hair pushed up. That's almost like their sort of alarm stance, his sort of dominance display that he's giving to us. And those white stripes apparently are supposed to reflect light into his eyes while he's in thick bush. I'm not convinced myself. He's actually stuck that hair up purposely. And I don't know if you've ever seen Nyala doing the dominance dance, but they put their hair up like that and then sort of dance around each other in a slow, sort of drunk dressage ponies. And I think that he's actually doing that display for us. I don't see any other males around. Beautifully, the light is coming through the stunning white on the back of his back. Displaying for us. Hello, big boy. Yeah, no, we are terrified of you. Just keep doing it. He's just looking to see that the cow is following, and she's just coming behind him, but we'll stay on the bull. Magnificent. And there comes the cow now. She looks to sort of be wondering what on earth the fuss is about, why he's got himself into such a twist. I mean, that's a Nyala in high agitation there. See, that's wonderful. Let's sneak a little bit forward and see if we can't get another view of him. Great. Ah, there's the reason. Listen to that. There was another bull here, and they took off and chased each other, and that's that alarm calling you can hear. So when often I say, oh, I can hear an animal alarm calling, and it's difficult for you, I'm sure, to understand what that means, unless you've heard it before. That sort of alarm, that bark, bah, 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 as they were running, is an alarm call. And they're just, it's obviously not always an alarm call. Clearly, it's a sort of dominance shout as well. So, I mean, much as I'd like to say that he had been doing it for us, clearly he was demonstrating for another bull. That was a really special sighting. We don't often see that at all. Of you saying how dainty and twinkle-toed they are, and I must agree with you, they are very dainty and very twinkle-toed indeed. Bashing through there. Now the leopard that we were following is headed somewhere into this block. And I wave it dramatically with my hands like that because the block is so vast. Through it. And we might have to do that a bit later on, but at the moment the best approach is to do a circumnavigation onto the road. heard something there. We're just going to pop across to Scott quickly. He's got some interesting birds, and we'll see you now.
Welcome back, everyone. And we are following some female leopard tracks that led us to this waterhole. And we didn't find the leopard, but we did find this beautiful sight of a grey go-away bird quenching its thirst. Really, really pretty, and they've got that bizarre crest on their head. And just thought we would rush you away from James to show you there. Seems to be a little bit of a playful nature to these birds this morning, and they've kind of been chasing one another around from drinking points, trying to get the best spot. As you can see, it's a very still morning here in the Sabi Sands. There's not a breath of wind, and it makes for a great reflection on that water. Well, I hope you all enjoyed that quick sighting, and we're going to send you back to James and continue trying to follow these female leopard tracks. So we'll see you all a little bit later.
Hello, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed those birds having their drink. I'm hoping to find some elephants having a drink later on, but you never know. Now, if we look at the sky, Bryan, if we may look at this front. The dawn broke, I think, fairly warm, and Bryan was just agreeing with me, and that's often a herald of a front coming through. And you can see the sky turning from azure to a more elephant skin-toned grey as the front comes in. And how the weather works here generally is that the fronts bash into Cape Town. Cape Town is a very beautiful city, but the wind does tend to blow a bit there. And at this time of the year, it normally blows either from the northwest or in from the sort of general westerly, and that's where the fronts come from, and they bash into the peninsula, and then they sort of dissipate slowly as they come up towards us, and they hit Johannesburg and freeze them to death. They have very clear skies, but they get very cold, and then they tend to come through here, and we get these slight sort of cloudy days like we had 2 days ago, and often they don't even reach here, but this is clearly, there was a big one that hit the other day, and this is the remnants of it now starting to come through. So often a warm day, warm morning, is a herald of some chilly weather to come. It's just a very nice termite mound here. But I don't see any termites that I can show you. I find myself fascinated with termite mounds. I'm not sure if that's a healthy obsession or not, but they're just a wonderful places to sit and contemplate, and just fascinating lives that the termites lead. Coming back sort of towards the area where we first found the tracks, and I'm afraid I think I'm probably going to call it quits on these ones and head back towards the Buffelshoek waterhole. I'm hoping that some elephants may come across for a drink at some stage. The drinking is very important in the winter. Bulleray and Molly are in two different ways trying to sort of assess the whereabouts and attract the Birmingham males, male lions. For those of you who don't know, five male lions, youngsters about to sort of become dominant and take a territory. Bulleray has been making contact calls through the ether to them to try and attract them to Juma. And Molly, you want to know where they are. Basically, we've just found out that they are northwest of us. And, well, not northwest of us, they're pretty much due north, a little bit east. And they stole a kill from the Nkuruma Pride last night. Nkuruma Pride managed to kill a buffalo. And apparently those one of those males took the kill from them. The others are around. But what is interesting, apparently there's a big lion calling in Manuleti. And that's quite a long way north of us. And apparently that's creating something of a stir because the Birmingham males are not quite at dominance yet. And apparently they're acting in a very sheepish fashion, having heard the big dominant calling wherever he is in the north in Manuleti. So that's the lion update. There ain't a lion on Juma right now. Right, while we carry on looking, we're going to pop across to Scott. He's got some tragolaved antelope, similar to the ones we saw before, but much larger. And we'll see you just now.
Welcome back, everyone. And there are some beautiful male kudus here. But they've been acting quite bizarrely. We saw one mounting another one earlier. So, obviously getting a little bit excited. And it is that time of the year when mating happens for kudu, but typically it's not with the same gender. So that was a bit of a surprise. And we're going to try and stay with them for a moment or to see what happens next. Timing is everything out here. And I'm hoping that they are going to at least show us a little bit of their interesting behavior. Then all three of the four came together and they were all kind of nuzzling one another's heads just before you came to us. But now they are back to some more typical kudu behavior, and that's browsing on leaves. What I've loved about this morning's drive and between the two different vehicles, we've managed to show you a lot of different game, a lot of different species, and I guess that's almost thanks to not having any big cats stealing the limelight. And it just goes to show how naturally the drives will develop and allow different animals to showcase their beauty depending on the specific day. And today the cats have been eluding us, but the drive's not over yet, so there's still a chance we could bump into any of the big cats, and we're certainly going to keep searching. Yeah, I'm just going to ask you to pan across to the left quickly. There's some impala that momentarily were sparring one another. They may have another little go at one another quickly. So it's not only the male kudus that are a bit worked up this morning, you could say, trying to mount one another, but also the impala. The impala, however, have finished their mating already. And these two will simply be practicing for next year's rut, where they will compete with one another. And let's see if they do it again. Oh, surprise! There's two more! Look at the speed of them, and the speed of Wium on the camera, both impressive. But incredible to see their agility. And it gives you an idea, these are two much younger bulls. And isn't this wonderful? The dust getting kicked up from their hooves, and even more have joined. Making it tricky for Wium to decide what to do. There's action everywhere. And it gives you a good idea of exactly how dry and dusty the environment is at this time of year. And it will continue to become even more dry and dusty until October or November, when we can expect our first rains. There's some lapwings flying overhead, making that racket. And they're kind of directly above us. Maybe cheering on the impala for a bit more action. It's interesting that we are watching these impala vie for dominance, or at least practice vying for dominance. And those lapwing just came down to land, so they seem to be possibly having a dispute between other lapwing. But we've got a question through from Bullaray relating to antelope and how they may fight or attain dominance over one another, and she's interested to know that the kudu, or she's observed that the kudu have yet to, well, she's yet to see the kudu doing that same ritualistic slow motion dance that the Nyala perform, and they don't do it, Bullaray. That's why you have yet to see it. It's just the Nyala that perform that strange ritual called phyloerection. And kudu will either look at one another, sizing one another up, or potentially clash horns, like these impala are doing right now. I'm just going to reposition ever so slightly, so that we're in a better angle to watch these impala. This is really great to see, and not something we see very often. Interestingly enough, this is the same clearing where we come and play touch rugby. So this is our rugby pitch, but today it's the arena for the impala. I couldn't help but take a look at those Senegal lapwing that were flying past, making an absolute racket. They ended up getting chased away by some Burchell starlings. So it's not the most hospitable environment, the Knobthorn clearings here on Arethusa this morning. The impala are having a go at one another. The birds are also chasing one another around. And it certainly is making for some wonderful viewing. It's great to notice the different size and shape of the different aged impala here. The two that are fighting now would have been born in 2013, in November or December 2013. And the other one's possibly a year or two after that. And male impala will become sexually mature at 4 years of age. So the smaller ones aren't quite there yet, and neither, I think the other ones are possibly just 1 year older. Well, Molly seems to think that the impala are really looking in good condition, and they certainly are, but I'm fairly confident that they would have been in their most prime condition during the month of May, and that's when the males will be most actively rutting and fighting with one another, and they expend a lot of energy over those months. Wow, look at that. And now that it has become very dry and food is not as easy to find, they will be starting to ever so slightly lose condition. The summer months are the most lush and plentiful for the herbivores, and typically at the end of excuse me, the summer is when they are most looking at their best. But because they are mixed browsers and have a very wide diet, they can maintain great condition even in the drier months of the year. And isn't it wonderful that we are not only viewing these impala fighting, but viewing them fighting live? This is happening this very second. And if you've just joined the show, it's important to know that it's not only live, but it's also interactive. So please send your questions through to hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions at wildearth.tv on email. You can see the kudu making their way out in the background, and you can also hear the horns of these impala clashing. It is possible that they can kill one another when fighting. It doesn't happen often, but on two separate occasions on walking safaris, I've come across freshly impaled carcasses during the rutting season, and those horns are very, very sharp. And we were just chatting yesterday, there goes another kudu in the background. Awesome. What a beautiful scene this is. They've obviously realized that there's different levels of expertise and experience here, so the three youngsters are wisely only fighting with one another, and the two slightly older ones have also picked a more even battle. But now, as I say that, let's see if there's a bit of bullying that occurs here. The one larger individual has back to the even bout. And this is very playful now, and I think it's because it's warming up and they are feeling quite jolly this morning. And they can now take this time to play around with one another. It's very useful play because, as you can see, they are practicing what can be quite ferocious battles. We managed to show you one, or I did at least, during the actual rats. And the intensity of those clashes was far greater than this. And rightfully so, it's not worth taking risks. The animals often don't have health plans or medical aid schemes and good doctors like we do, so us as humans can tend to take bigger risks and under-rationalized risks, whereas animals will like to often rationalize their behavior, and that makes perfect sense, I guess. Mm. Okay, well, as much as I have been loving this sighting, I have heard some updates on the radio waves, and there's something else quite interesting that's happened, and I'm going to try and get us into that position. So, let's continue and see if we can't get lucky further up ahead. Rosie, and thanks for sending your question through. Rosie would like to know whether the slightly older impala were having a kind of tutorial role teaching the younger impala how to spar with one another. And yes, I guess kind of through default that's what's happening. The younger will naturally watch the older males doing what they're doing and pick up some tips on what and what to do and what not to do. That certainly is a very plausible theory. Well, while we try and get a little bit closer to some excitement, we're going to send you back to James, and we will hopefully see you in a short while with some interesting stuff. See you later.
Everybody, welcome back to Jiga. We're now sitting in the company of some rather magnificent antelope, the waterbuck, Cobus ellipsiprimnus. They're four young bulls, and they're often in this area. And they will just be very nervous of staying around the territorial bulls of the area for too long, because they are nowhere near dominant yet. But they're rather splendid fellows. Now, the reason we've come down this road is, well, we're happy to see the waterbuck, of course. But yesterday, Andrew and I found a parrot nest, and it's just up ahead. And we're hoping that maybe the parrots might actually be in residence. Very beautiful, and they're attended, of course, by the ubiquitous drongos, and you can hear the parrot calling in the background there. Very metallic kind of scraping sound. Chip, chip. There we go, you can hear them. We had that lovely question the other day about why it is that rangers wear khaki, and I gave you a fairly lengthy explanation of the fact that we wear it because people expect us to wear it, A, and B, because it, I mean, it became traditional with the sort of theme of the great white hunter, and that's what they used to wear. Look at the, if you look at the waterbuck now, I can just about see them, and they're a grey-brown. They're much darker than the khaki that most of us wear, and it makes them far more difficult to see, especially in this vegetation. You can see how perfectly colored they are for this vegetation type. And that gray-brown color, I think, is by far the best color you want to be. The paler you are, the more obvious it is going to be for animals to see you. And that's because the light tends to reflect off the brighter colors. See what a brilliant color they are. When they stand still, you can't see them at all. We'll just sneak a little bit forward. You can see the white on their backsides, of course, which is probably supposed to be a following mechanism. We tend to kind of write off any back end whiteness as some sort of following mechanism. Any unusual thing on the backside is a following mechanism. Not always sure that we're correct. Just beyond here, one crossing the road at a gentle passage. Now, when the bush goes green, of course, you might think to yourself, well, that must stand out against the green. But of course, in the green, the big advantage is that when it's green and thick, you can actually get behind the bush. And so being less obvious isn't such a crucial thing. Also, to become green as an animal is, I don't think any mammals achieved greenness, actually. And it's, in fact, one of the most rare pigments in the bird world, the color green. It seems to be quite difficult to manufacture. And so when it's blush and green, they just go into thick bush to hide. A number of references to dressage today. There's waterbuck tend to have a very attractive extended trot, for those of you who are perhaps horsily minded. Daniel, very nice sort of antelope-based question. You want to know, do the impala and possibly also the waterbuck fight their siblings during the rut? Absolutely, they'll fight their siblings. They'll fight everybody. All other males of breeding age during the impala rut are fair game for a fight. There's a big bull there. Can you see him there, Bryan? He's just sort of to the right there, yeah. There are two big bulls. And you can see how much bigger they are than these youngsters. These youngsters won't fight at the moment, Daniel. They'll be pretty chilled with each other. And then when they get to the size of the bull that Bryan will show you now, you'll be able to, when they get to that size, as soon as there are females around and those females are in estrus, there will be an enormous conflagration. And waterbuck make an incredible sound. If you can actually hear them fighting long before you can see them. They're great skulls clashing into each other with a tremendous thump and a sort of echoing clatter, far more than any of the other antelope. And they're one of the few antelopes that will actually stab each other to death at times. Most of them, it tends to be head-butting, and eventually one of them gives up. But these guys can be pretty vicious. And I suspect their viciousness has got to do with the fact that they do like to set up territories around the water. And if there isn't, you know, the less water there is, the more violent, I suppose, the territorial disputes will be. So they're not territorial in an environment like this, but around the water, they tend to be very territorial. Beautiful colors coming through. Really nice sort of winter light filtering through the gray. There's something about the combination of green and gray and gold and gray that's just very beautiful. You can hear the drongos. You can hear the you can hear a little bird party going on here at the moment. A whole lot of, that's the
drongo. As you can hear, there's a drongo mimicking a robin. We've got southern black tits, crombex. Drongos. Parrots calling to the far side. Isn't that lovely? So I'm just going to let you sit. We're going to sit for 10 or 15 seconds in silence and just have a listen to the kind of peaceful atmosphere being created by the birds and the sun on our faces, which unfortunately you can't feel, but it's a rare privilege to have the sun on one's face, and I don't think we appreciate it often enough. White-browed scrub robin going off to the east of us. And then that drongo is actually, he's also doing a black-crowned chagra, which goes. And that's exactly what the drongo is doing. You can always tell it's a drongo, though, if you listen carefully, because they've got slightly higher-pitched voices. Crombex going. Little waxbills with their waxy or their very strident little whistles. Beautiful. The waterbuck have moved off into the bush. The parrot nest I can see, Bryan, straight down the road there. There's a dead tree that's sticking out onto the road. You see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So when we get up there, you might have to be quite smart with your movements. Oh, there's a batelier sitting on the parrot's nest. You see that? There's a batelier there. There's a parrot nest on that tree. It's on the underside. In a hole, and I'm sure the batelier is there by chance, but it might be quite interesting to see what comes out. Let's go and have a look.
Hello, Daniel. A question about the relationship of or the similarities between the white-tailed deer that tend to go into the rut where you are in America and the antelope here. It's a very similar kind of sort of behavior where they're fighting over territory and for dominance all over girls. There's a lot of sort of antelope and deer fighting over girls. Right, we're going to drive very slowly up here and just see if we can't spot the parrots. If we can't, we'll just enjoy the batelier. You have asked a difficult question to answer. And those are the best kinds of questions, of course. All right, we're going to stop here. I'm just going to, so you can get a decent picture of that batelier. I just don't want him to fly off. So while I answer Edward's question, Edward, you want to know why it is that drongos will mimic other birds. In fact, why, and therefore you can ask a further question, why do any birds mimic other birds? So out here we've got the robins that do it, we've got the drongos, we've got the you hear that little pearl-spotted owl.
Anyway, Edward, the larks do it. The Sabota lark is a particularly good mimic. The jury is probably slightly out as to why birds do it. It probably is for competition, and certainly some of the research amongst the robins would indicate that those that can do the most bird calls are most likely to mate. So it might be something to do with sort of a peacock's tail situation where sexual selection has made it so there may not be an actual environmental reason for the calls. It's just simply been evolutionary pressure towards being able to do more calls. But other than that, it doesn't make enormous sense. And so I'll get back to that now, Edward, and there are a few more things to discuss in it. And then, John, you want to know about minor birds. A minor bird is basically mostly like a starling out here. And we don't have any minor birds here. They're not related to the drongos particularly closely. We do have a minor bird in the area, and that's called an Indian minor, but it's from India, not naturally occurring in Africa. The one other thing just to say about the mimicry, Edward, is that I don't believe that it fools other birds. So, for example, when a drongo does a pearl-spotted owl call, if I can hear the difference, I'm pretty sure that the birds can hear the difference. So why it does that call, I'm really not sure. And if it's only the males doing the calls, you know, it's difficult to say. So there's a lot of interesting information on bird mimicry. Of course, if, for example, and I'm going to try and get a bit closer to that bataleer now, if a bird does mimic, so let's take a robin, for example, and we know that the robins that can, the male robins that are able to mimic the most birds are more likely to breed. And that might be a sexually selective thing where that's just occurred over time. But the question turns into why. Why is that an advantage? Why would a female select a male that can do more calls? What is it indicating to her? By the fact that he can do that many calls, what's it indicating? It might simply indicate that the offspring will also be able to make more calls and therefore attract females, and so you get into this sort of positive feedback loop. But if you go backwards in evolutionary time as to why that actually happened, why that sort of sexual selective pressure started to be exerted, it becomes more difficult to answer. One of the theories is that they make a territory sound full, and so there's more food resource available, and that then might attract more females. That's one of the theories. Edward, lovely question. Thank you for flummoxing me this early in the morning. We're going to try and get a little bit closer to that parrot's nest and to the bataleer. Beautiful bird, the bataleer. You will read books that tell you that bataleer means tightrope walker in French, because it flies like this. I've never met a Frenchman who can tell me what bataleer means, though. So if you happen to be French and watching us, and you know what bataleer means, please will you let us know. I've had a number of French guests, and I've said, oh, look, there's a bataleer. It means tightrope walker in your own language. And they've said, no, it does not. It is not a word we understand. So if you can perhaps find out for me what bataleer means, if you are French, I'd love to know. B-A-T-E-L-E-U-R. B-A-T-E-L-E-U-R. Stunning, stunning bird. Just going to sneak slowly closer and closer and see if we can't get him to totally relax around us. Normally don't get much closer than we are now, and you can see his beautiful red head now. Just going to check if that's a male or a female, a bataleur. Right.
you can tell if it's a male or a female by checking out when they're flying. It's very easy. But that rufous bit on the back of the can either be white or rufous. Isn't that lovely? But the primary feathers are the key there. So if you look all the way down the wings, the male has got plain black, and the primary feathers are basically those white bits on the end of her wings that she was shaking, and that's a female. With the white bits on the end of the wings there, that makes her Mrs. Batelier or Madame Batelier, and not Monsieur Batelier. That's a magnificent picture of this incredible bird. So we had a question earlier today about endangered bird species, and this is one of the sort of more threatened species that we get here. Only occurs in protected areas. Now, Bryan, I would suggest you keep the camera on, basically on that area, because there is that that parrot nest is basically underneath. That's general section, yeah. That's basically where it is. So we might see them pop out. They may have left already, but let's go a bit closer and have a look. This is an old dead marula tree, everybody, and the marula tree's heartwood apparently tends to be quite prone to infection, and so funguses and bacteria will get in there and eat away the heartwood, which makes it good for hole nesting birds. You want to get him flying away, Bryan? Let me stop. Ah, isn't that wonderful? Now just watch how he flies. When she flaps. Beautiful. So I have my own theory for, in the absence of a genuine French person telling me why that thing's called a batelier, I suspect it may well be a word that has been sort of derived from the way it flies. It flies, if you see it flapping its wings like that, it looks like a bat in flight. I don't know if you noticed that. It doesn't fly with deep wing beats like most of the... if you watch a vulture take off, they've got much deeper wing beats, and same with the eagles. That bird's got very kind of fast wing beats to get up into the air quickly, and a bat flies exactly the same way. Well, not exactly the same, but in a similar fashion when it takes off. And I wonder if that isn't where the word came from, where the name came from. I don't see any parrots. We'll just show you the hole. You see the hole there, Bryan? So from Chris, we have... So we have some couple of answers on the batelier question. It would seem that my bat assumption is possibly wrong. Apparently a middle-aged old French word from... This is from Chris and others in Zurich, I think, in Switzerland. It means acrobat or tumbler or circus performer, which doesn't make great sense for the way that it behaves, but that's possibly where it comes from. So maybe, actually, not got nothing to do with the flight, maybe to do with the color on the face. Now, that would make a lot more sense. So thank you very much for all your answers on that. And we'll press on. There are no parrots here. So,
I think it's a very old French word, which we got from Switzerland. Thanks for that information. Nice question from Jake and Kylene about the batelier. Jake and Kylene, you want to know how rare is it to see them? In this area, Bryan, I suppose we probably see them every day, really. So we do see them every day, flying over or like that in the trees. But they are long-lived, slow-breeding birds, and they don't survive outside of protected areas. They don't survive in farmlands or in cities. Because they tend to need, I'm assuming it's because of the amount of prey available, and they eat quite a lot of carrion, but they have a very sort of specific niche that they need, and they can't be disturbed, so they don't survive in fallow lands or in urban forests or farmlands. So they really need these protected areas. So they're common around their distribution where we find them. But outside of here, they're not. And so, because the protected areas are obviously limited in space, there is not a huge number of them left. So we're now on the deep southern boundary. And what we're going to do is head towards a waterhole here. And then possibly just go and check if the hyena den is active. It was yesterday, which was great. And while we're doing that and driving along this not particularly picturesque road, we'll go across to Scott and get an update from him, and I'll see you a bit later.
Well, I've got bad news, everyone, and apologies for getting all of your hopes up. There was a report of one of the Matimba male lions seen close to the Arethusa airstrip this morning, but when I went to go and try and find him, we had no joy. It was very thick in and around the thickets east of the airstrip, and that's where he was last seen. So, unfortunately, I've got nothing to show you, but we are still in the area of where we've had tracks of shadow and sandile. So I've just rushed back here in the hope that we can maybe get lucky and find them. Now, even though we have worked this area already this morning, there's nothing to say that the leopard hasn't popped its head up now or got into a more favorable position where we could see them. Certainly worth our while to come back here and have one last look around. What will happen with female leopards who leave their cubs when they go hunting? They often move in circles, circular movements back towards where they've left the cub. The time frame in which they'll return to the cub varies greatly on the individual leopard and the circumstances that she is facing. But there is a chance that she also could be coming back into this area, laying a fresh set of tracks, which will help us to fine-tune the search. So that's what I'm hoping for. Happy to hear that you had a beautiful sighting of batelier eagles. They really are spectacular looking birds, and again it's just great how you the viewers get exposed to basically two game drives in one. The guests who are out here on safari are stuck on the vehicle that they head out on in the morning, whereas you guys have the benefits of chopping and changing between the two, essentially doubling what you would typically see on a drive, but I guess it all depends on whose vehicle you decide to jump onto. This is where the impala were fighting a little bit earlier. And again, it just goes to show how things can change and timing is everything. Now there's not even an impala in sight. Yet earlier, and not much longer, not very long ago, we had a wonderful sighting just here. Now, hopefully, the impala have moved off and the leopard have come in. We had the tracks coming down this road in front of us, towards us, and then from this junction it looked like they went that way, or at least tracks of one, possibly the male. We drove around, didn't find any sign of him, but then found tracks of, in all likelihood, the female that looked around in another direction, kind of away from him. So that's where we're going to be heading now, doing another loop through this area. I haven't copied any updates. Just wondering where the Birmingham Coalition located this morning. Okay, copy. Thanks very much, Tex. Well, I've just got a really, really interesting update. Copy that, Tex. Thank you very much. So, really interesting update from Texan. I'm not sure if James has told you this, but the Birmingham Coalition, just one member remained in Buffelshoek. The other four continued north into the Manyaleti, and they've been heard calling. So that's why the guys know that they are in the Manyaleti, the other four. But the one single male that remained in Buffelshoek came and chased the entire Inkahuma Pride off their kill, off I think is a buffalo kill that the Inkahuma Pride managed to catch. And isn't that phenomenal? One lion chased another eight away from a kill. And out of the eight, there's five adult lioness and junior, who's a fairly decently sized sub-adult male. So, interesting stuff. Sadly, we weren't a part of it, but it is happening very nearby. And just like we were discussing in the fireside chat last night, there's going to be a lot of interesting behavior with lion. And within 12 hours of us saying that, something unfolded last night, and we're certainly going to keep tabs on the lions and their movements as much as we can and keep you updated with these little bits of info. And ideally we will actually show you some of the action, but we are currently not in the right place to be able to do that from here. Okay, keep your eyes peeled. There is a leopard here somewhere. It's just a matter of where. Another lion related question that's come through from John in California, and it's not a light-hearted question. It's quite sad what actually happens in Africa, and John's interested to know, is there still canned lion hunting? And for those of you who don't know what canned lion hunting is, it's basically where lions are raised in captivity and bred in order to be shot. So, there's an impala running around behind us here. So they aren't wild animals, they are bred in captivity, and then often it depends on the nature of the individual operation, but sometimes they can be shot within a very small cage, or sometimes they can be moved into a bigger, more natural looking pen that the hunter will then go and shoot the lion in. Now, all of these obviously are very controversial, and ethically, some people may disagree completely with what's going on. So, what did you see there, Wium?
No, it's a squirrel.
Okay. So, yes, it does happen, John. There's debates as to whether it's a good thing, because if you breed lions in captivity to cater for the hunter's needs, it means that wild lion can be left alone and continue living their natural life. So that is one argument that people may have be in favor of, but it's entirely up to everyone to have their own opinion. I am not going to get involved in that, but it is important to know that canned lion does still happen. Quickly, there's a bird that you've just seen with James, and it's flying past, and it's going to make for a great, great view. Look at that. Well done, Wium. Now, you can see it teetering from side to side, as James described to you, and that's how it's got the name, the acrobat. In French, or the performer. Great work, Wium. And that was a male battler. You would have seen that underneath his wings he was half black and half white. Well, thanks for that question, John. Sadly, yes, it does still happen, and we're gonna send you across to James now. He's got some good news for all of you. See you a bit later.
Everybody, just up ahead on the road, and I always like to stop out here, is a remarkable carnivore of Africa, one you've probably seen before, but one of my favorites, and just beautifully hidden here amongst, with its colors, amongst the sort of vegetation, a bit like that waterbuck was, and you can see her there, just sitting on the top of the termite mound. Isn't that wonderful? Given such a bad rap by the Lion King, there's nothing stupid or giggly about Crocutta, Crocutta, the spotted hyena. Right, let's just pop in there and see if the youngsters aren't there. Now, what to do, continue my experiment of seeing if I can smell the predators. Going very slowly, there's another one there, at least two. Hopefully the youngsters will come out and try and steal the oil caps again. Is that alright, Bryan? Got at least two adults here. I'm not sure where the youngsters are, but they might pop out and say hello to us. She's looking quite concerned at something. Apparently yesterday, the female you can see there put her nose into the hole and pulled, or didn't pull, but called out the babies. I would love to have seen that, and I'm hoping she's going to do the same thing now. I was very jealous when I heard it on the radio. So we'll just sit here for a little while and see what they do. It's starting to heat up a bit. I'm also going to sit here for the next 10 seconds or so and just be very quiet and see if you can hear anything. as you've probably heard, there almost no sound at all. I can't even hear a bird calling, just a gentle rustling of the breeze through the leaves. And if, in case you've just joined us, or perhaps you've forgotten, you might be able to please do send through any questions you have to hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. And she does look enormously fat right now. It's possible that she's pregnant. I think it's unlikely, though. Maybe she's just had a big fat meal. She does look astonishingly fat. She's also got a lot of moisture around her mouth, and I suspect that's from her drinking. She's probably had a big drink at one of the waterholes nearby. She's in much better shape than the one that's lying on the ground there. She seems to have hips. Oh, here comes a little one. Brian, there's a little one to the left there. Yeah. Isn't that lovely? I think they are so cool. Oh. Such naughty little faces. Apparently, this little fellow here had an injury on his right back leg a while back, and you can actually see it there. It's healed nicely. There's a little patch on his back of his right back leg. Now, I'm trying to see if that's a male or a female. Not easy, despite obvious external extremities. That to me looks like a young female, actually. The pseudo penis does not have a sort of a pinched end like a proper penis does. Oh, look at that. Isn't she sweet? Hanging around with Mum. Mum might be pregnant again. It would be very spectacular. Oh, look, there's a tiny one. There is a new one. See that, Bryan? Look at that! It's a brand new little baby! That's not, I mean, that's not born now. It's, you know, its eyes are open, but that's no more than a, that's probably a week or two old. Oh, wow. She definitely can't be pregnant. Look at that little thing! Look how sweet. Very, very nervous. But won't be for long. Will become like its naughty, naughty sibling fairly soon. Oh, that's just too sweet for words. She must have given birth in the last week, maybe 10 days. What a magnificent thing to see. Sorry, that's me just turning. Look at the little ones coming up again. Very special indeed after a particularly quiet morning. We've got 3 minutes left, and so I'm going to greet you fondly in Scott's, on Scott's behalf, from Scott and Wium. Thank you for your questions. Thank you for bearing with us on what has been a quiet drive, but on a magnificently beautiful morning. And thank you for your questions and contributions. Big thank you from to Bryan and from Bryan on camera. He is about to show you his magnificent thumb. And a big thank you to Nikki and Tara as they multitask their way through the final control. And thanks from me especially. It's been a quiet but beautiful morning. And we're going to spend the last 2 minutes or so just looking at these incredible hyena, and especially that little baby cub that's just come out. Hello, John. You want to know if the mother can fit down the hole? No, John, I've stuck my head into that very hole, and it's not very deep. So what she's basically doing is just blocking any possible entrance. She's just keeping that little cub safe. Oh, look, there it is again. I think that's probably a week old, if that. Oh, that's just too sweet for words. And she will be concerned now, very vulnerable now. The little one will come back, come skedaddling back if anything happens. Ordinarily, we might try and go round and just check what that little thing is doing the other side, but I think we'll stay here. We don't want to frighten it. And we're going to leave you in the company of these 1, 2, 3, and now 4th little hyena. And I hope over the next few days and weeks, we're going to be spending more and more time with that special little cub and watching its development. So from all of us at Wild Earth, thank you again for being with us. It's threatening to be another tremendous Kruger-Lofelt winter's day. So we're going to enjoy it, and I hope that you will enjoy your evening or morning wherever you happen to be. We'll see you this afternoon.